snore. Ah heck, I overslept. I'm late for work. I have to hurry and clean up the trash before the inspector sees it.
Ah yes, Snail Cleaner, my lovely mess of a game that I made from our first ever game jam. Even though it's far from perfect, it is a game that I am very proud of, and one that I learned a lot from developing. So join me around the campfire, and hear the story of how Snail Cleaner came to be. So it all started about a year ago. I had been thinking for a while about participating in some form of game jam, but having only 2 days to develop a game, which is how a lot of game jams do it, felt a bit intense for me at the time. But one day, while scrolling the interwebs, I saw the GE Jam number 3, hosted by Game Endeavor. The game jam was quite beginner friendly, you had a whole week to complete it, and there weren't any strict constraints for the development. It seemed like the perfect way to test my skills as a developer. So I decided to join the jam, and eagerly awaited for the theme to be announced. On the eve of the game jam, I sat glued to my computer. The minutes ticked by, and at 6 PM, the theme was announced. Duality. I sat the rest of the evening brainstorming possible game ideas, twisting different concepts in my mind and trying to come up with something that resonated with duality. And after a few hours, I had absolutely nothing. I couldn't come up with anything that made me excited, so I decided that maybe this wasn't for me and went to bed. The next day I was talking with a friend and I said, yeah, I think I'll skip the game jam. It was an uninspiring theme, I couldn't come up with any ideas. We talked a bit more about game design. I had recently had in mind some sort of cleaning game, so I joked that, okay, look, an absolutely horrible idea for the game jam that I'm not gonna do, but like, imagine that you're a cleaner, but like, you're also the trash. Like, I don't know, a snail that spreads its slime everywhere and also has to clean it up, wouldn't that be a fucked up idea or what? And we laughed. Haha, yes, that would be a stupid idea. So naturally, 2 hours later, I had started building a prototype of a snail cleaning game, because I could not resist the meme. So yeah, I guess it was a good theme after all. The most important goal was that the cleaning itself should feel satisfying. Kinda like when you peel the dried paint of a paint bucket, or sweep off the dust of something that hasn't been dusted off in a long time. Sure, there would be other game mechanics and whatever, but the satisfaction was the focus of the game project. The first step of making the cleaning system was to figure out how the slime should be constructed. I could have done a Noita and simulated every pixel on the screen, but that felt like a bit too much, so I instead chose to represent it using slime chunks on a medium-sized grid. Each slime chunk would range in dirtiness from 1 to 0, and if it reached 0, it would disappear. For this to work, I needed the player movement to also follow the same grid lines, otherwise it would look kinda weird. So I drew myself a cute little snail sprite and implemented some grid-based movement for a player character, complete with some juicy squishing animations and a pleasant walk sound. I then made it so that every step the player took, a pool of slime would be placed underneath them. So okay, we have a snail that walks around and spews out slime, but how do you clean up the slime? Here I try to use people's pre-existing conceptions of cleaning. How do you remove a stain? Well, you take a rag, soak it in water, and rub it against the stain until the stain is gone. I replicated this kind of motion by checking if the player's mouse was on top of the slime and if it moved above a certain speed. If it was, the slime was gradually cleaned up. The mop, however, is perhaps not one of my visual designs that I'm the proudest of, but it did the trick. To make the cleaning satisfying, I also needed some good audio-visual feedback. The gradual disappearance of the slime was done with a shader. I used a kind of comic book raster effect, which might have clashed a bit with the pixel art, but I thought it looked cool, so I didn't care. Once a piece of slime was fully cleared up, a pop sound played along with some sparkle particles, which felt quite satisfying. So, okay, I have a snail that can walk around, spread slime, and clean, and it feels kind of satisfying. So, now what? This is a stage of game development that I struggle with quite often. You have a toy, something that is kind of fun to play with, but it's not really a game. There is no direction to it. You can play around with it, but there's no challenge or problems to solve as a player. Now, you don't have to turn every toy into a full-fledged game. Sometimes, the best fun you can have with an interactive media is when you just fiddle around with it and create your own fun. But I wanted to take the step and actually make a game out of the toy. And for that, I have a little two-step process. Firstly, you need goals, things the player wants to achieve. And secondly, you need obstacles, things that hinder the player from achieving said goals. The goal I came up with was to have multiple rooms that the player had to clean up. For the trash, I designed a banana peel with a funky animation and sound that disappeared when you touched it with a mop. The player would have to reach the trash, clean it up, and cover their slime trails. But there weren't really any obstacles to this, so I took some inspiration from those old-time Flash stealth games, where you had to dodge the gazes of guards. My version of this was a giant eldritch eyeball that followed the path and gave you minus points if it ever saw trash. Thus, the game became a stealth game, where the player had to clean up rooms in time so that the inspector did not see any of the trash or slime. So I sat down, created a few rooms, then added some story, instructions, doors, and other stuff that came up, and finally published the game a few days before the deadline. I was pretty happy with what I had done. It was basically my first game that I actually completed, and that was an amazing feeling. If any of y'all are interested in starting game design, I highly recommend joining a game jam. Having a prompt and a deadline does magic for creativity and your ability to finish things. But what was the reception for my game? Well, mixed. People liked the art, especially the eldritch floating eyeball, and they also liked the concept of the game. But there were a few pain points. Firstly, a lot of players thought that I did something wrong.
Is there a way for me to not get too huge minuses for no reason though? Game is really fun but frustrating cause I am always in minus 15 after the first stage.
Game was fun, but I never knew how the inspector actually saw, so I think I cleaned up way too much of my own slime. Some music would be nice, but otherwise, solid game smiley face.
Now, why did this happen? Well, you remember the inspector. He gave player minus points whenever it saw trash. Fair, but there was no way of gaining points, meaning that everyone only got negative scores. My idea was that it would be some sort of high score where the goal was not to collect as many points as possible, but rather to lose as few points as possible. Now in isolation, this would not be a problem, but people have a lot of preconceived notions about how things should be. If I had represented it as some sort of health bar that went from 100 inspection points and down, people would probably have understood how it all worked. But scores? Scores generally go up. Sure, there can be losses of scores in games, but not only losses. And to the player, this felt like they obviously must be doing something wrong. Otherwise, they would have a positive score. The main takeaway here is that as a game dev, you have to play along with your player's preconceived notions. If you want to break with tradition, do it with purpose and because you want to achieve a particular effect, not just because it was the first solution that you came up with. Secondly, oh my god, what can the inspector actually see? What the inspector could see was not clear. There was another comment that suggested adding a highlight to things that the inspector saw.
I think maybe you can mark the slime and banana somehow, like change color or add a frame when it is seen by the inspector to help the player understand what the score gets minus from.
Which made me a bit confused, because I had literally implemented a feature where an exclamation point effect was shown above objects detected by the inspector. So when I read that comment, I was like, pfft, stupid players that don't know how to literally look at the screen. But then I looked at the exported game that is up on the web a week ago and the exclamation points are not there. Apparently they excluded themselves from the export, for some reason. Fuck. So yeah, test your games when they are exported, not just in the editor, because sometimes the exporter tool does stupid things. Another thing that probably would have made it easier to understand how the inspector worked would be to have a sight ray. Floating eyes are known for shooting rays, so it would not feel like that much of a stretch. This way, there would not be any confusion in what the inspector could see. So, did Snail Cleaner achieve what I set out for it to be? My main goal was for it to be satisfying, which I think I succeeded with. But the stealth mechanics kinda took away from that experience. Having to dodge the inspector's vision became more important than cleaning up, which meant that you didn't get the satisfying experience of fully cleaning the rooms. It was also quite hectic, which is kind of antithetical to the Zen experience of cleaning. But even with its faults, I am very happy about how Snail Cleaner turned out. I learned a lot from working on it, but more importantly, it gave me the confidence that I could actually make games. I hope you liked this look back at my first ever game jam game. Have a good one. Cheers.